we can stop the rain. Welcome to Decent Life. I'm Lou Polifido. The call-in number is 212-245-7273. 212-245-7273. The guidelines for calling in are is to lower the volume on your TV or computer because we don't want to have any feedback while you're calling. And also while you're calling, please listen to your phone and not the show because we're on an 8-second delay, which means I'll be hanging up and you'll be calling back. And if you like, you could give us your first name and the location from where you're calling from. And as you know, it's campaign season. Last Thursday, we had Mel Wymore, and today we're welcoming Jamel Henderson.
Yes.
Jamel,
yes,
welcome
to
the show.
Thank you so
much. It's honored for you to be here. We really appreciate it because we like to get diverse opinions, you know, try to reach all neighborhoods so everybody could be well-informed. And Jamel is a Democratic candidate for New York City Council 41, and basically he's a native New Yorker. Right. And from that point on, you know, can you give us just tell us a little bit about yourself?
Sure, absolutely. So I just turned 32 last Saturday. So
happy birthday.
Thank you. And so, yes, born and raised in Brooklyn. I started out in East Flatbush. I'm the youngest of three children. We're all 1 year apart. My brother, Daheem Henderson, and my sister, Shakira Benjamin. Both my parents, the late Warren Henderson and the late Nancy Benjamin, both are deceased. I was also in foster care for 8 years under the leadership of Concord Family Services, which was at that time one of the best agencies you can find. And I was truly honored to have an amazing foster mother, Sister Betty Robinson, who passed away in 2004. And so I currently live in Kingsborough Houses in the Crown Heights section of Brooklyn, and where I am a three-time CUNY graduate, all while living there.
Wow.
Yeah.
You know, it's hard to stay focused, you know, sometimes, and that's terrific. And also, I heard that you, in 2008, you were you won the Young Adult of the Year award.
Yes.
I mean, that's terrific. That comes from Albany, doesn't it?
That was through my church, because I'm a member of Bridge Street AME Church with a Reverend David Cousins, my pastor. But the church and the church community recognized the work that I've done, and I was just truly honored to receive such a prestigious award at that time.
Okay, so you've been in the neighborhood for some time.
Yes.
And what prompted you to take this step forward? Because I know you've been very active, you know. From the list you have of things, everybody, you know, you could go to his website to see his accomplishments.
Yes.
But, you know, you figure like you're like 50 years old or something what you did, what you're doing. So what made you go from, I believe you were in Community Board 8 for a while, and now you want to be in the City Council.
Yes.
What specifically made you want to run for City Council?
So what it was for me was that I've had this passion for a long time, since I was a little boy. I remember with my watching, you know, political talk shows with my father, listening to radio shows with my dad. And I've always had this issue, concern about the community at a very, very young age. And so what I did was to follow my passion. I said, as a little boy, I'm either going to be one or two things. Either I'm going to be a lawyer, or one day I'm going to be president. And so the lawyer went out the window, but I still have a passion desire to one day be president. And I knew that I had to start somewhere. And so after being a three-time college graduate, after receiving my master's degree last year through the National Urban Fellows Graduate Program at Baruch College, I said that I think it's time.
Mm-hmm.
And after the results of the election of 2016 and hearing President Obama's final speech where he challenged the community and challenged the nation that if you don't like what you see, to organize, petition, and run, I said, all right. It's time to do it.
All right, so you're picking up the challenge.
Yes.
Say, hey, you know, we got to set this right. Because what happened is, I think, is that a lot of parents told their children don't be a politician. At least people my age, my generation. Don't go, it's a lousy thing because we got better. And what happened is somebody had to fill the spot.
Mm-hmm.
So now, we have, not people who shouldn't be in politics. And it's good that you and others have taken up the challenge because we do need good people to really go in and lead the city into a more, you know, we situation. You know, let's get together, let's work together. And it all starts, You know, and I like that you were religious, you know, you associate with your church, and it's terrific. Yeah. But I got one thing I have to ask you is that, what do you mean by if you work hard, you can play hard?
Well, I've always believed that, you know, I've noticed in life, in my 32 years of life so far, like, a lot of people take things so serious. And don't get me wrong, from the CEO to the President of the United States on down, yes, you have a job to do, but that doesn't mean you can't be human. You know, you should have a right, mm-hmm. as a matter of fact, a natural right to clock out, exactly. where you can be yourself. Because unless you're the president, even certain CEOs, the moment you walk out those doors, the world doesn't know nor necessarily care about who you are.
That's right.
And so you should be yourself and enjoy what life has to offer. The moment you get so caught up in, you know, work and things like that, you lose yourself. You become robotic.
That's right. And maybe you think you get full of yourself.
Yeah.
That I am so important that maybe I should be earning more money. Maybe
right.
So it goes down to different roads. But so let's get to some issues that we're looking at. I think since the gentrification of the Upper East Side, because that's where I came from, mm-hmm. you know, when I was a little kid, I don't know if it initially started there in New York City, mm-hmm. but I do remember well-respected people today having people back then bash on doors with baseball bats. Get out of this building. Mm-hmm. So I don't know if it still exists today, mm-hmm. but for housing, what do you see housing specifically in your district and maybe for the city?
Mm-hmm. So in addressing gentrification, I strongly feel that it's a double-edged sword, because it's not just the gentrifiers. I feel like it's not their fault. You know, what's really at stake is the people who make the decisions, the stakeholders, and that's the real estate developers. The real estate developers present the neighborhood in such a way where it attracts a different kind of person.
Can you just hold that note for 1 second, please? Okay, I hate to interrupt.
No, go ahead.
But, you know, we do have a caller, and I like to get questions from the
people. Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. Hello, you're on Decent Life.
Good afternoon.
What's on your mind?
You know, Lou, I know you haven't heard from me in a while.
Hey, buddy, how are you?
All right, man. You know, I want to first of all congratulate you on this mayoral one.
Thank you. You know, I'm going to need a little help, so, you know, contact me on my website, because I need people to help me with my petitions.
That's right.
I caught you off guard.
I got a question for both of you guys.
it's Jamel's time to shine, not mine. This is Jamel, so we're focusing on Jamel.
You know something? You're attempting to be the big cheese. So we need to know a few things, my friend.
Okay, so you think we have a rat problem? Is that what you're saying?
This goes far beyond the rat problem, because the rats don't have to worry about budget cuts and affordable housing that's not affordable and public housing cuts. Now, you know, they had a big, some busloads of people went to the White House the other day and to HUD headquarters to protest these federal cuts. Now, you know, Trump is, of course, we know what his game is. Already, but as far as you two gentlemen are concerned, let's say, for instance, if you do get elected, how would you help fight these federal cuts that are going to be to federal housing? NYCHA needs repairs. Affordable housing is not affordable. The homelessness is on the rise, and it's not because of gentrification, like your guest just said. It's because people basically don't trust these shelters. That's why they won't go. So what are you going to do or what are you guys planning on doing to address these problems to the middle class? Thanks, gentlemen, and good luck, Lou.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, so how are we going to do this? I guess the question was, is that with all the federal budget cuts and everything else, how are we supporting, you know, housing?
You see, this is where I feel the strongest portion of what my vision is for not only for the 41st District, but well as for the city, is to really become so civically engaged. I think it's important that we work with our federal elected officials, okay, because federal and city are on two distinct playing fields. And so while federal policies do impact city, government and city, you know, the city life, it's very important that we work closely with our federal elected officials. So, like, I know in my district, my congressman is Hakeem Jeffries. So I, if I'm elected as city council, will work closely with him to bring those issues to the table, but as well as work with the community to get minds together at the table to create a policy that can counter the policies that, you know, President Trump is doing right now.
Okay. And let's focus on de Blasio.
Yeah.
Because I believe I was, you know, looking at the New York City website,
mm-hmm.
and for the New York City Housing Authority, there's something that they're calling Next Generation. Have you heard that yet? Where they want the actual housing want to be self-sufficient.
Mm-hmm.
They want to create, don't depend on the federal government for the money or the state government, but how to focus on the housing that we have and how do you generate an income, because they're all like a $17 billion deficit right now to take care of stuff. At least that's what's according to the website. I'm not exactly sure. But, you know, yeah, so we have to think outside of the box on what we can do with this. And to me, I look at it as if with him is that we need to, I think you hit it on the head, we need to work together to try to get things, because developers is all about, okay, I don't want to get crazy phone calls, but about greed,
mm-hmm.
all right? How much can I do and how much? So how can we say, you know what, let's represent the city. If only 10% of the city's population is high
people,
then 10% of housing new should be 10% of high-end people.
And that's where I come in, because I say to the community and to with respect to my district, that it's important that we have a true definition of what affordable is. That
exactly.
word is being used so, you know.
Right. Is it public housing?
Right.
Or is it
something
you could afford to
rent
an apartment?
And so having those definitions is really going through and having independent research where you can identify the annual median income of that particular community. So that means if a family of four on average, the AMI is $54,000. That means that any developers who are developing housing in that community should not go beyond that particular cap. This is a way that you show true affordability, because you don't want to push everyone out. Okay. And regardless of what real estate developers and other people may say, the mere fact that I live in a district that is seeing it firsthand, there is not a level of understanding that they will be able to comprehend until they see it for themselves. People who've lived in the community for decades and have a cultural identity in the community are being misplaced because they want to attract other people.
Exactly.
And you can't do that by pushing people out.
Right.
There has to be affordability.
And it has to be diverse, because mm-hmm. when everybody's living together, everybody forms a different opinion of people and have more empathy involved mm-hmm. with that. I just have one more question
on that,
because I saw the Moving On Up program.
Yes.
What is that in particular?
So the story behind that, I was home late at night, I was watching The Jeffersons.
All right.
And the song's in my head, because, because the goal is to move upward. And in our communities, there isn't an opportunity to move upward. Like, I'm proud to say that as a three-time CUNY graduate, I live in Kingsborough Houses at this moment. But my goal is to move upward to the next level. I want to be able to show people in the community that we can become first-time homeowners, that people can move out of public housing into a decent apartment. And those who want to be in a decent home, they can do that. And so that's why I say it's moving on upward, because there has to be a
path to a nice
same exact way.
Right. So. Because, you know, everyone needs a chance and everybody needs hope.
Exactly.
Going on is that we're talking about community. You're talking about community policing.
Mm-hmm.
What exactly does that involve? Do you want everybody, I guess, to talk? Or?
Yeah, so I discovered this one as part of my graduate program. I was doing my mentorship in the city of Indianapolis under two distinct mayors, Republican mayor, Mayor Hoxha, who's the current mayor. One of the things that they pushed was community policing. That means I've seen firsthand officers, knowing people on their particular streets, developing a relationship with them, kind of taking it back to where my grandmothers and grandfathers would tell you, you know, if that police officer stop you, then you're not going to get a butt whooping in this day and age. But it was just a whole, you know, the people accountable.
Right.
Because when people see law enforcement officers not only as them doing their job, but if they can develop a relationship, a personal relationship, then it increases the chance of the community to work with the police to fight crime versus saying, I'm not going to tell nobody because I don't want to be a target.
Right.
And so having that community police is not just developing relationships with people, but having an actual, you know, sense of activities where you can actually play ball with them or sit, you know, talk with, you know, the elders.
So how does that lead into, because I saw also something like a council for gang members.
Mm-hmm.
Is this the same concept?
So, yes, because I feel like, you know, gang activity is happening in our community.
Right.
And so they too have power because they influence people. And so if my vision is, if I can have them at the table to influence them to do some good things, then it will begin to shed a positive light to a degree. Because at least my vision is, I'm giving them another option.
Right.
Versus doing the wrong thing. It's kind of like when you was growing up, you know, you get in trouble the first time, you'd be like, oh, well, nobody told me. The second time you get in trouble, you can't say nobody tried to help you.
No, that's
so
right.
That's how I'm looking at it.
And what's interesting, though, is with a lot of gang members, you know, they're pretty smart people.
Yeah, very smart
and
people.
They just need to focus.
Right.
And you have to, you want to go in and change community,
right,
so they can focus on other
right.
things. And because just recently on the news, we saw that the two moms, just gone down. So how much is the gang violence going on and the guns? Because I see some of this. We still have cash for guns out there?
I have not seen ads lately. I know under the leadership of our late district attorney in Brooklyn, Ken Thompson, that was aggressively pushed. And not only that, but he had the opportunity to clear summons and everything like that. And so I've seen that happen, but you know, I haven't been seeing that program promoted out there recently.
And another program that I think that you're looking to do is financial literacy and empowerment.
Yes. I cannot stress the importance of our communities to save and invest. Our communities spend a lot of money on things, and that's not a bad thing, but you need to have investment power because other communities are doing the same exact thing. They're putting money into the stock market, or they're putting it into a money market account or an investment account.
Just put it in the bank?
Right, just put it in the bank, but also having wills and deeds to move, you know, to carry wealth over to the next generation. And if we establish those things, then you will see the economic growth develop in our communities directly.
But it's really a tough thing to ask people to save because nowadays it's very hard, even myself.
Absolutely.
So, you know, I think that's it's a great point. But if you're in a low-income neighborhood, it's kind of like, people are gonna be chasing after you.
Right. It is definitely difficult because I know myself, like I'm currently unemployed and I'm going all in with this campaign. So I understand firsthand, you know, the importance of saving.
Right.
But, you know, the same mindset I feel is that when we see something we want, we're gonna do whatever it takes to get it.
I got you.
And so we gotta have that same mindset in terms of the building financial literacy and independence.
Like creating a budget.
Yes.
Trying to say, okay, this is how much I have, even
right.
though it's not much, how do we
right.
budget it and try to have some discipline
right.
on spending it instead of all of a sudden going out and
right.
you know,
and
spend on something.
It will be my job to bring in financial institutions that will help to teach the community, but also I'll be providing through my office ways where people can get started at such a small cost. Because every little bit does help.
Okay. And I see you have another council. I'm not sure. Are you associated with the Council of Fathers? And the Council
yes,
of Mothers?
I feel because I've lost both my parents, I feel like it's important that our community establish a strong bond in the family. And so I would love to hear mothers at the table with me address issues and current concerns that they may be seeing in the community and how they can utilize my office to provide them resources to help them to be better mothers in terms of, you know, if they need assistance or after school programs or, you know, health facilities, and as well as fathers, because unfortunately in our communities, fathers are not promoted and highlighted in the same magnitude. And there are great fathers out there who are raising their kids and are doing a spectacular job despite their circumstances, despite their situations. And I want them at the table as well.
And I believe there are studies being done that fathers has a very important role out there. And so fathers, it's not just at the point where you had your fun. You know, there's a responsibility because there is a child out there looking for both parents, for both of them.
Yes.
And that's one of the issues. And then if they go look for role models out into the street, we're creating more gang members.
Yes. So. Because the way how it looks is, it's like a ball of energy. Mm-hmm. And positive energy radiates, positive energy gets emitted. But if you show negative energy, they're going to use that source to find it somewhere else.
Okay.
And that's what tends to happen. You have to have a distinct bond. Because like right now, both my parents are deceased, but I have a second mother or a second father where I can go to and they provide me guidance and love.
Because of the foster care, it sounds like you went into a pretty good organization. You found a great grandmother.
Yes, I was fortunate, very fortunate.
So do you see, since you had the fortune side, did you ever see the dark side? Is there anything that you want to do with children's services?
Yes, I think first and foremost, our kids in foster care that needs to be on the forefront in the city's agenda. I think it's important that we recruit and train adequate foster parents who really care about these children. I know what exactly, and definitely not to check. I could tell you from both sides, being a foster child and working for the agency, the mindset, unfortunately, of some of our foster parents.
And within the community, because I noticed that there was health and wellness, and you had a concern about mental health in the community. Mm-hmm. Exact way, what do you see? Is it like it's a social thing or lack of understanding?
It's definitely a way where people need to open themselves up and express themselves. I can tell you, everything that I've gone through in my life, if I didn't open up and share it, I wouldn't be sitting here before you now. Because think about it. I lost my mother. I lost my father. I lost my first foster mother. I've been on my own since 17. My sister lives in Albany. My brother lives in Queens. And I'm doing all of this at the same time and dealing with this. Like, having that mindset, I know there's many people out there that don't have their parents, so you understand what I'm dealing with, but being able to open up and deal with depression and confront stress, like, these are things that we have to talk about.
Right, because everybody needs a support system.
Yes.
Even if just to talk to someone.
Yeah.
And, you know, and it does a lot of good.
Yeah.
You know, me, sometimes I go into another room and screaming.
Right, right. Sometimes you got to do that, or, you know.
Let it out. Yeah.
Right.
So somehow, yeah, it's great. Do you think it's the financial aspect that it's not enough coming in?
I think it's not just that. I think it's us leading by example. I think we have to be open to say that it's okay to speak to a therapist or speak to a resource. But then we have to define it. We have to educate them. I think we have to educate our communities on what does it mean to speak to a therapist? What does it mean to about mental health? Because unfortunately, we still, when we hear mental health, we think of, unfortunately, mental retardation or somebody slow.
Right,
and that's not the case. It's so much broader than that.
Right. Right away, when you talk like that, it's a lot of negativity.
Yes, it's negative.
And I don't think in any neighborhood you get that pushback.
Right.
I mean, geez, if I just talk to my wife, what do you mean?
Right, right. Like, it's okay to sit down and talk, because I could tell you, when you release that stress and whatever is on your mind, you feel so much better. And if I have to lead by example, which I'm willing to do, I will do that.
That's good, because, you know, change starts with
right.
On your website.
That's right.
You know, we're coming up to the close. Well, mm-hmm. I know we're talking about a lot of stuff. Is there anything in particular, that any message that you want to send out? Have I done a good job?
I think you've done a fantastic job. But I do want to say this to everyone out there that's watching, that your vote in American democracy is the most powerful tool that you have. And we're living in a society right now where systematic politics does not work anymore. We need people who's going to come in and be directly a servant of the public first. And that you should be able to walk away feeling that my elected official has done a fantastic job. And so that's why I'm stepping up into this. I know I'm taking on the machine, but I love it because I'm dealing with people directly. I don't have to worry about anyone else. I'm dealing with people. And that's what I'm here to do. I'm here to serve
the
public.
And I want you, and hopefully you are inspiring other people
to
get
I'm
going.
I'm thankful.
Because what it is, don't worry about your education, per
se.
It's your common sense.
That's right.
You know, when you have common sense, you know, what's right and what's wrong and how to deal with things. So please don't get confused about that, because we really need to get rid of career politicians.
Yes.
Or know-it-all business people, mm-hmm. who think they know better than what we are,
yes.
the average person.
That's right.
And we need to head towards that way. And you know what? We got one more minute. Small business ownership. What do you think we could do on that?
We got to have more small businesses in our community that recycle funds back into community, that hire people that look like us, that is going to really bring the community together. A lot of small businesses, they come into our particular community, especially in our district. They collect our money, but it doesn't get recycled back.
It's still somewhere else.
Right. And so we want to make sure it stays in the community, because that's how you build the economic stability.
Exactly, because we're looking to promote and grow every community, and it starts with diversity.
Yes.
Diverse population. Mm-hmm. We can't, with public housing, it started segregating people. Mm-hmm. And the word affordable housing sounds like segregation.
Yeah.
Segregation. But we know we don't have that much time, and I just want to thank you for being on the show.
It's an honor to be here. Thank you.
Jamel, thank you. And just one more thing, too. I think I forgot. Kamana Kamkwalala, thank you for producing the show today.
Thank you.
I appreciate it. I'm sorry I don't have the graphic for you on here. And she is terrific.
Yes, she is.
And it lessens the burden on me. So it's great. But, when we inspire people,
yes.
we show them that, we can stop the rain.
That's right.
And all you need is love.
That's all
Thank
it
you
is.
For coming again.
Thank you.
Thank you for watching.